Alright, this video is to introduce and explain our fifth extension to our 552nd sub-prediction for the fire signs of 1 Kings 18, which as usual we think is correct and the last one that we shall have to make of these. And here's all the reasons for that. We realised with our previous extension, the fourth to the 552nd sub-prediction, that although the fire signs occur at a Pentecost, because the entirety of 1 Kings 18 is Pentecostal, it's not a Pentecost festival as we first thought, because Elijah is not competing against the 100 prophets of Jehovah who watched the contest, he's competing against the 450 prophets of Baal. So the Pentecost will be a Baalian Pentecost, if you pardon the phrase, a Pentecost to do with false worship, to do with prophets of Baal. Now, when a church changes from a true church to a false church, when it falls as a true church, the prophets within it cease to be prophets of Jehovah and start to be prophets of Baal. And the Watchtower fell as a true church, 2005 Sivan 10, and Laodicea, which is a part of the Watchtower within it, which took our baptism, they fell as the true church, 2013 Heshvan 1. And the period between those two is 100 months. 100 whole months from Tammuz 1, 2005 to Tishri 30, 2013. So 100 whole months. And that is the 100 men in the cave, the Laodicean cave of robbers who stole our baptism and our understandings. The 100 prophets of Jehovah in the cave, the Laodicean cave, are those 100 months. And they were prophets of Jehovah whilst they were in that cave and whilst it was a true church. But when they became a false church, Laodicea, due to the transgression causing desolation, which for them we think was 2007 Nisan 14, Passover deception, when they, although knowing they were Second New Covenant saints, partook as if they were 1NC saints, as if that's going to fall God. They did it because they loved the glory of man more than the glory of God, like most humans do. But the glory of God is better and real and has a meaning. Man's judgment is garbage. We glorify people who aren't always worthy of their glory. God doesn't make those mistakes. They became a false church, 2013 Heshvan 1, and the 40-month wilderness penalty began then. So the prophets of Jehovah in the cave for 100 months of Laodicea became prophets of Baal on Heshvan 1, the 101st, beginning of the 101st whole month. The contest is resolved at a Pentecost after then, and 24 Pentecosts after then is 24 times 50, which is 1,200 days or 40 months, or the length of the wilderness penalty. So, the fire signs occur on the last day of the wilderness penalty, which is the 24th Baalian contest from starting with day one as the fall of Laodicea, when their prophets of Jehovah became prophets of Baal. That's when all the prophets of the last group, which therefore meant all of the prophets of Jehovah, such prophets as they had, became prophets of Baal. Baal means lord or master, and the master of the Watchtower became Satan when Jehovah rejected them, and likewise with Laodicea. That's why it's the best interpretation of a Pentecost that could end this contest we've so far made. All our previous ones have been either for an actual attempt at a festival of Jehovah, Pentecost, which wouldn't be appropriate since we're not competing with Jehovah, we're competing with Baal. Jehovah's competing with Baal and we're competing with the prophets of Baal. And our previous attempt, as I say, was actually of a contest Pentecost, which has a relevance but isn't quite as good as a Baalian Pentecost. Now, the other thing about this 24th Baalian Pentecost, which is quite simply the last day of the wilderness penalty, the 1200th day of it, which is the 24th times 50th day of it, is it is also the 78th Pentecost from when I sent the Sign of Jonah letter, which proposed the contest. Sending that letter established that the Watchtower was a false church, because they had already accepted my baptism, and so they'd accepted I was Elijah by not disfellowshipping Laodiceans, and they decided they wanted to compete with Elijah, and that's the position of a false church. Obviously a true church would cooperate with it, with God's prophet, not compete with him. They were exposed as Baalian. They already were prophets of Baal in the Watchtower, other than the Laodiceans. The non-Laodicean JWs were already prophets of Baal, although they weren't really prophets. Anybody who was doing any prophecy Bible research was in Laodicea, pretty much. But the reason that it's also Shabbat 30 is not only the 24th Baalian Pentecost, but also the 78th Pentecost after my Sign of Jonah letter, is that Elijah mocked the prophets of Baal at noon, and he mocked 450 prophets of Baal, and the sentence count of his mocking is 6 times 450, because, you know, he said perhaps he's asleep, perhaps he's on holiday, perhaps he ought to wake up, and the number of things he's doing is 6, and there's 450 prophets of Baal, 6 times 450 is 2700, and that is 7.5 years, and that is the period of his noon mocking. Now, noon in Hebrew is the word light, jewel in the jewel. So it is two lights, jewel light. Now, the period of jewel light is during the contest begins during Elijah's mocking to do with the contest. The contest didn't begin on 2006 ER1. I sent the letter then that proposed the contest. The contest began on the first day when... Well, the first prediction day that failed, because on that day people were looking, oh, has Gordon got it right, as he to the Lord's witnesses, is Elijah going to do it? And the answer was no. So that was when the contest began. But it was proposed 41 days earlier, on ER the first. But my mocking began then, because the letter completely slammed the Watchtower. So mock for 2700 days, 7.5 years, from ER 1, and that takes you 2006, and that takes you to Heshvan 1, 2013, when there was no longer a double light, because Laodicea became a false church, and therefore its light was extinguished. So it became single light. It was no longer noon, using the literal meaning of the Hebrew word for noon, which is double light. Although, of course, that the origin of the use of that word for midday is that the light is greater at midday. Why it would be double, I don't really know, but certainly it's the maximum amount of light in a day. So we're now saying that this contest is resolved by a fire sign at the 24th Pentecost after Laodicea fell, which is the 78th Pentecost after the date of my Sign of Jonah letter. And incidentally, we got this understanding, this new understanding, on Shabbat 21, which was the 77th contest Pentecost. So our previous, the fourth extension to the 552nd sub-prediction, was for Shabbat 21, because we recognised that was the 77th BLC contest Pentecost, and that's when we thought the contest should be won. And it was won then, in the sense that, from God's point of view, when he's got the second answer through to his prophet, the contest is won. I mean, assuming the second answer is in fact, assuming we've got it right now, if we have it right now and there is a fire sign on Shabbat 38R1, then it will be the case that the contest was actually won when we were given by God the second answer, which would be Shabbat 21. Now that's the 77th Pentecost of the contest. So all the arguments that we produced about the validity of the 77th Pentecost hold true, not for the fire sign, but for the answer from God, which makes more sense, because that's how the contest is ended from a divine standpoint. I mean, we don't realise it's ended, or we do, perhaps if we're right, but nobody else does until the fire sign occurs. But that doesn't mean, you know, Elijah said, answer me, answer me. He didn't say, conduct two terrorist attacks. The significance of 77th Pentecost is that Jesus was the 77th in line from Jehovah through Adam, the maternal line of Luke 3. And Peter said, you know, how many times do I forgive my brother should he sin? Is it up to 7? And Jesus, no, up to 77. Because forgiveness didn't come from Enoch, who was the 7th in line from Adam, who was Jesus, who was Michael. It came from Jesus, who was the 77th in line, not from Adam, but from God. Except that he was the 77th in line from Adam, if you say that he wasn't the son of Joseph, because the scripture in Luke 3 says he was the son, as the opinion was, of Joseph, but actually he wasn't. He was the son of Emmanuel, who was the son of Joseph, because Joseph and Mary gave birth to this guy, Emmanuel, who was in the line of David, who had the body that the Messiah possessed at his baptism when he was 30. So when Emmanuel was 30, he went out to get baptized by John the Baptist, and his spirit shot up into an angel, and Michael's spirit came out of an angel, represented by the dove, landed on his head, and that is the spirit going into his brain. The brain is where the spirit runs, because the body is hardware. The brain is the IT hardware, and the spirit is the software from God. The spirit of God is in fact software. So Michael's spirit entered into Jesus, and Emmanuel shot into heaven. And so actually, Jesus was the 77th from Adam, and the 78th from God. Hence, you can have either of these two numbers as a release. So after 77 times, we're released with the second answer, and after 78 times from the proposal of the contest, from the Sign of Jonah letter, we get the fire sign, which releases contest watchers, and also releases us from nobody's going to listen to us until we do a sign, since we keep saying what we're going to do with it. So that's all the 77, 78 and 24 Pentecosts, all the Baalian satanic Pentecosts of the contest, which is between Elijah and the prophets of Baal. But we can actually get more accurate than Shabbat 30, would you believe, or we think we can, from Revelation 9:15, and I think the verse before, which says that, and the sixth angel who had the trumpet said, untie the four angels, the ones bound, upon the river, the great Euphrates. Then it says, and the four angels were untied, the ones having been prepared for the year, the month, the day, and the hour to kill a third of the men. Now that has to be counted, because it's got numbers and days and all sorts of stuff. And initially we didn't count it correctly, but whenever you have an instruction followed by a fulfillment, you have to count them both. So, untie the four angels four times. The ones bound upon the river, the Euphrates. Now, Haggai the prophet counts as two times. One for Haggai, one for the prophet. And the river, the Euphrates, counts as two times. But if you're bound on the river and bound on the Euphrates is bound upon the river, bound upon the Euphrates, that counts as one plus one, bound upon the river, upon is add. And bound upon the Euphrates is another one plus one. So that's four times. And there's four angels in that position. That's 16 times. Then you have to untie them. That's four times. And then you do untie them. You're instructed to untie them four times. They're bound upon the river, the Euphrates. That's 16 times, as I just explained. Then you actually untie them. That's another four times. So that's 24 times. And then you've got four angels who are prepared for the year, the month, the day, and the hour. That's 4 years, 4 months, 4 days, and 4 hours. So you've got 4 years, 4 days, 4 months, 4 hours, plus 24 times, which will take us days, because it's certainly not years, it's not months, and 24 hours is really boring. It's just one day, or two if you take them to be hours of a 12-hour day. So that will be 4 years, 4 months, 28 days, 4 plus 24, and 4 hours. And we were prepared to kill a third of the men. This is by baptism, and it's a third because it's four angels, and there's 12 angels who are apostles in total. I mean angels, because they're sanctified, and they a third of the men is a third of the saints who are going to come into this church, because four angels, that's four out of 12 apostles, four out of 12 tribes, one third of the church. So one third of the saints is what these four angels will kill, and the other two thirds kill to the previous form of worship, and not only that, kill to Adam. Because when we baptize them, we kill them in a very real sense. I mean, they don't know that they've died. But what happens is they go to sleep at night in an Adamic body, and they wake up in a non-Adamic body. And that is actually the first death, because the first death is sleep. The only difference between the first death and your normal sleep is that if you've died, you wake up in a different body eventually to the one you went to sleep in. whereas when you don't die, you wake up in the same body. Well, when you have your body changed overnight from Adamic to non-Adamic, you wake up in a different body. Therefore, you've died and been resurrected. So they have a kind of sleeping death resurrection thing, which means they're killed. So that's why it's a third of the men that are killed. It's actually a baptism. And that baptism begins 4 years, 4 months, 24 plus 4, which is 28 days and 4 hours after the preparation was completed. And that was completed when we were appointed in Zoah at 2NC First Fruits on Tishri 2, 2012, over Zoah. So you count 4 years from that and you get 2016 Tishri 2. And then you count 4 months and you get 2016 Shabbat 2. And then you count 28 days and you get 2016 Shabbat 30. And then you get 4 hours and you get 4 hours into Shabbat 30, because when one is appointed, there's then 7 whole days of installation to the before you can start operating. So one's generally appointed at the beginning of the first day, so you get 7 whole days rather than 6.5. So we therefore expect the second fast sign to fall at the 4th hour of the day on Shabbat 30, which would be not quite as simple as one might think to calculate, because it's not 4 hours after sunset, because an hour is a 12th of the night or the day. So it's precisely a third of the way into the night of Shabbat 30, which is February 2. So a third of the way after sunset into the night of February 2. And sunset in February 2 will be about past 5. So, and a third of the way in will be, nights are a bit longer now, aren't they? Because we're not this side of the solstice. So it would be 5 hours in. So it'll be about past 10, something like that, on February the 2nd. In either the UK time zone or the US time zone, depending, we don't know which one's first, the UK or the US. And then the next bomb, the next fire sign, will happen on the next day, which is Adar 1. We know that because Jesus comes upon the clouds in Matthew, but he comes in the clouds, singular, in Luke. And he comes on Adar 1. After the wilderness penalties ended. So there is a bomb which he comes together with or in on Adar 1, which is the third fire sign. But the cloud of the second fire sign is cleared up or ended. He doesn't come in that one. He comes on it, or certainly has happened anyway, on the previous day. So that sentence counts of Revelation 9:15, which is plainly going to tell you the day, month, year and hour, which is why the scripture said, being prepared for the hour, the day, the month and the year, to baptize all these guys. And of course, the Adar 1 is the first day of the acceptable year, the new secular year, delayed 5 months from the old secular year, which is occasioned by the new Passovers, just as occurred in Egypt. When they had a new Passover to leave Egypt, they also had a new secular year, they had a new sacred year. Had a new year anyway. And the brilliant thing about this Adar 1 date is it is a monster Sabbath. It is first of all a festival Sabbath of new Rosh Hashanah, because it's the beginning of the year, this new secular year, which will apply to the kingdom of God. We're not changing the sacred year, still Nisan 1, but the secular year becomes Adar 1, so that the last will be first. The last month of the sacred year will be the first month of the secular year. And the kingdom is all about first being last and last being first, because many who are first in this system will be last in the kingdom, which is good, because at least you're in the kingdom. And actually, the best thing to be is probably first in this system when you get all the luxury, and last in the next system where it's actually, you don't want to be the king because you have to serve everybody. So being first in this system and last in the next system is quite a good plan from a sort of comfort perspective, and also because people are resurrected first, last to first. I mean, it's just fantastic. You know, you resurrect your dad, he resurrects his dad, and everything works backwards. But this date, it's Adar 1. It's a festival Sabbath of new Rosh Hashanah. It is also the weekly Sabbath, It is also the monthly Sabbath, because the Jubilee, the second of the kingdom, and the first of Zohar, the monthly Jubilee, was Ab 2016, because that was 50 months after Sivan 2012, which was 50 months after Iyar 2008, which was the first whole month of the Kingdom of God. So it's a monthly Sabbath, the first day of it, and it's the annual Sabbath under Jesus, because he started reigning 2010 December 1, that was his first reignal year anyway. And so the first secular year is 2010 Tishri 1, and the seventh secular year begins not 20, well, it begins 2016 Tishri 1 for people not in this church, because it said in Exodus 12, this month will be the first of the month for you. And it was true of God's people, it wasn't true of the Egyptians, they didn't change their calendar. So likewise, Isaac, which is the true church, the sons of the ICC, the Isaiac Church Covenant, people with the water baptism, those guys, the secular year is Adar 1, but Abraham, people with faith but not in the true church, and Adam, people with no faith and not in the true church, well, not enough faith, those guys, they're still on a Tishri 1 secular calendar. So Adar 1 is a festival Sabbath, a weekly Sabbath, a monthly Sabbath, and an annual Sabbath. It couldn't be more of a Sabbath. It's the ideal day to release everybody. It's the most Sabbathy day you can possibly have, other than Atonement Day, which is Adar 10, with this new calendar. Since we're doing that, every temple is inaugurated 22 and a half years after its commission. True of Solomon's Temple, which was commissioned 1048 Nisan, inaugurated 1026 Tishri. True of Zerubbabel's Temple, which was inaugurated 515 Nisan and commissioned 538 Tishri. True of Jesus' Temple, which was inaugurated 33 Nisan, and 11 Tishri was when he was commissioned, and then he went to speak to the leaders of the synagogue with his, when his parents left him behind and didn't know where he was, when he was 12. And all churches have this pattern, it's the fundamental pattern of all churches. So we know that we were appointed 1997 Tishri 2 over the two NCs, and so we were appointed to feed 3.5 years before that, which is 1994 Nisan 21, first fruits. And then 22 and a half years after that will be Booths, Tishri 2016. And we would normally be inaugurated as a temple. This is Solomon's temple, actually. It would be inaugurated 2016, Tishri 15 to 21. But that isn't really Booths anymore, because the secular year has been changed. It's been bumped 5 months back. So the 22 and a half years becomes 22 and a half years plus 5 months due to the calendar change. And we celebrate a Booths. In fact, first Watchtower cakes at Booths, Adar 15 to 21, and that's when the temple will be inaugurated. Okay, so 1 Kings 18, go back 7 times. This is all about a generalized Pentecost. What is the definition of a Pentecost? A Pentecost is the day after a count of 7 Sabbaths from a zeroth Sabbath. That's a Pentecost. And furthermore, that day is a holy convention and is a festival Sabbath. There's your definition. And normally, in the Law of Moses, the 7 Sabbaths that you count are weekly Sabbaths, but that isn't the definition. They can be festival Sabbaths. They can be any type of Sabbath. The generalized Pentecost is, as I say, the day after 7 Sabbaths counted from a zeroth Sabbath. So in 1 Kings 18, we start off by taking, instead of weekly Sabbaths, we take mandatory festival Sabbaths. And in fact, it go back 7 times. So it's mandatory festival Sabbaths to which we went. And starting by, Elijah goes up to the top of Carmel, and then he sends his attendant to look, who sees nothing, the zeroth Sabbath, and then go back 7 times, 7 more Sabbaths, and then the Pentecost is the day after that, which is both a festival Sabbath and it's a holy convention and a Sabbath, so it's a festival Sabbath. So basically it's the festival Sabbath after that, annual festival Sabbath. So in the case of the first fire sign now, with this understanding, you go to top of Carmel, beginning of the kingdom, 2008, Nisan 22, The first festival after that we attended, mandatory, was 2008 ER14, and that there was a no-show then, so there's the zero Sabbath. Then you go back to seven more mandatory festivals after that. We didn't do booths that year. We did do the Pentecost, so we did Pentecost that year, then three more in 2009, then three more in 2010. That takes to booths 2010. Then the next mandatory festival after that, which we didn't attend because we didn't know when it was, but the next Holy Convention, the next festival, Sabbath, was Heshvan 21 or Chislev 21, the late version. And that's when the fire sign occurred in Israel, the largest fire in the history of modern Israel on Mount Carmel, where this contest was set. So that's the first fire sign. The second fire sign, we go in Rosh Hashanahs, okay, which is another Sabbath. You can count them if you want. So you go to the kingdom, 2008 Nisan 22, which was a prediction. We thought there'd be a fire sign then. And it's a no-show. There was nothing happened. So that's a zero Sabbath. Then you count seven more Rosh Hashanahs, which takes you to from 2009 to 2015. Well, normally you would then go to the festival Sabbath after that, not necessarily the Rosh Hashanah festival Sabbath. But it's ambiguous. You could interpret the Pentecost as you go, you count seven Sabbaths, and then you go to the next equivalent Sabbath. It doesn't say whether it's equivalent or just a Sabbath, a festival Sabbath. You can either go to the nearest festival Sabbath, or you could go to the festival Sabbath of the very same type that you counted, which would certainly be not be the case, actually, in the Law of Moses. You go to just the next day, which then is a festival Sabbath. But if we say this, the Pentecost will occur, or the Jubilee, at the next Sabbath of the same type as the seven, then you'd end up on the next Rosh Hashanah after 2015 Tishri 1, which is 2016 Adar 1. And that will be when the cloud is seen. I mean, there's the cloud would occur on Shabbat 30, but that will be in a certain time zone. And it will be seen on Adar 1 in another time zone, which does actually lead me to believe. The firstborn is in the US, that's right. So it can occur on Shabbat 30, but it's in fact seen by the British in Adar 1, because it would happen, that can't be right, it's the 4th, it's 4 hours in, isn't it? Well, the only way this could work would be you count the Pentecost to Adar 1 somehow, exclusively rather than inclusively, and say that the seventh Sabbath of the 24th Baalian Pentecost is Shabbat 30. In which case, Shabbat 30 is the seventh, and you can see the fire sign then. I don't like that at all, because the count, the Pentecost count, should start inclusively from the first day of the wilderness penalty. Mind you, that's a wilderness penalty, not a Pentecost count. You could do that. Or the alternative would be that maybe one doesn't get appointed first thing on Tishri 2. The trouble is that in an earlier part of the talk I showed that 4 hours into Shabbat 30 is when the fire sign occurs. And you couldn't possibly, 4 hours into a day, use a time zone to get two different dates. You'd have to be, you know, within, well, US and UK are only 5 hours apart. So you'd have to be, you know, within 5 hours of sunset to get that idea to work. So either the appointment doesn't happen at the beginning of the day, in which case I don't really know what use the 4 hours is. Anyway, so we'd have to do some more research into the hour. Or, as I say, maybe the Pentecost actually count. Maybe the zeroth day is, in fact, Heshvan 1. All right, so there's your count of seven Rosh Hashanahs, followed by an eighth Rosh Hashanah being the Jubilee or Pentecost of Rosh Hashanahs. So that's for the second fire sign. And then for the third fire sign, we're going to take these Sabbaths that we count to be 2NC Pentecostal Sabbaths. And rather than going to the top of Carmel, meaning the beginning of the kingdom, we're going to go to the top of Carmel, being the highest administrative point that we get to in the kingdom, which is the beginning of our kingdom administration, which is when we were appointed on Heshvan 2, 2009, after Satan's lease over. That was our kingdom appointment, post-satanic lease appointment. So the first Pentecost after that, 2NC Pentecost, was Heshvan 21, which was a no-show. So there's your zeroth Sabbath. Then you count seven more Pentecosts, which takes you actually to 2016 Heshvan 30, which is the new 2NC Pentecost, rather than Heshvan 21, which was the old 2NC Pentecost. It's changed because the new year has changed. And then you go to the festival after that, and the festival Sabbath after that is Adar 1. So that's three different applications, three fulfillments of the same set of words. And in fact, there are 16 or 17 in total from the sentence count, because the fire came down and it licked up the bull and the stones and the dust and the waters around the trench and blah blah blah, and there were 12 stones and added all up, and there's a hell of a lot of fulfillments. And all of them will satisfy this Pentecostal pattern, but not in weekly Sabbaths, as was the case with the Pentecost of Moses, and in fact of the Christian Church, but in festival Sabbaths or Rosh Hashanahs or any other form of Sabbath you like, as long as it obeys the definition of a Pentecost. 2 Kings 1 says that the second 50 that's sent, which is the second fire sign and the third actually, is a following 50. Well, the 24th Pentecost of Baal is plainly a following Pentecost because it follows the 23rd. And the 78th from the Sign of Jonah letter follows the 77th. So that's very, very straightforward, following Pentecost. Right, Haggai 2. Repeat 1. On the 27th to the month, in the 7th, the word of Jehovah occurred in the hand of Haggai the prophet. Now, we used to think that counted as 5 times, until we understood that Haggai the prophet counts as 2 times. So the hand of Haggai the prophet is 10 times, because 5 fingers times Haggai and the prophet. That word lasted 10 times, which is actually 10 days. And every 21st of the month in the 7th reignal year, or the 7th secular year of Jesus, is in fact a 21st to the month in the 7th. But Jehovah does tell everybody to work as a result of this, and don't be afraid, he says. Don't be afraid and work, for I am with you. Now, he wouldn't tell people not to be afraid unless something had occurred that would make them afraid. And he says, be strong. And there's no need to be strong unless something's happened that would make your knees wobble. And no one's going to start working until there's a sign. And that's what makes you afraid and makes your knees wobble. So this 21st is close to the sign. We thought initially it had to be the sign, but then, no. The word occurs in the hand of Haggai for 10 days, and then you can be strong because of the sign occurring. So in other words, it's telling you that Haggai gets the second answer 10 days before the sign. And we got the answer on Shabbat 21, and the sign is Shabbat 30 or Adar 1, 10 days later. Well, then you've got to bear in mind what I agreed with you when we left Egypt. Although the problem is, what didn't he agree with them when they left Egypt? He agreed a new year, a Passover, cakes, booths, the law, Pentecost, everything. So remember everything. Remember all festivals, basically, and the whole law of Moses. Remember the whole law of Moses and all the festivals. And then it says, repeat one, and I'm rocking the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry. Well, if you start with Shabbat 21, which is the 21st of the month and the 7th of Haggai 2, verse 1, you repeat one, well, you repeat a festival. Let's go to the next festival. That's Adar 1. And that's when Jehovah rocks with the sign. Now, Satan rocks with the terrorist attack, and that scares everybody. But just after that attack, when you digest it, you go, wait a minute, that's the sign of the Son of Man, if you're awake spiritually. And that will be Jehovah rocking. And also rock the watchtower, who'll go, oh dear, we are very surprised. Elijah has beaten the prophets of Baal. God has done better than the contest between God and Satan was won by God. How astonishing. But we better rethink what this means, because we really didn't expect this at all. So that'll be the rocking he does of them. So that's one meaning of it. The other meaning, which is really cute, is that because we're having the first of these Watchtower Passovers, Adar 14, and because there's an intercalary Adar this year, there's also a V-Adar 14. And what is God going to do? Is he going to kill people on Adar 14? Well, he can't, because Adar 14 isn't the end of Adar 14. V-Adar 14, or Adar 2 14, second Adar 14, is the end of the day. Because with this crazy original calendar of mankind, you actually get 2 solar days, 2 Gregorian days, that are the same lunar day. So he can't execute anybody on Adar 14, because for all he knows, they're going to attend the Passover on V-Adar 14 and be saved. So he has to wait till V-Adar 14. So in other words, he doesn't rock at Adar 14, the first Passover. he rocks at the repeat of that Passover with his Passover execution. So it says repeat one, small she, because it'd be the smallest Passover we hold. They'll get bigger and bigger as more people realise what's going on and get released from the entanglement and web of lies and deception of Satan. Repeat one Passover and then I'm rocking. So he's just saying, well, I'm not rocking on Adar 14, I'm rocking at the repeated version of that in the intercalary Adar 14. So I hope you're getting the flavour of this. When there's a sentence that's very ambiguous in the Bible, what mankind has done, typically being as satanic as we are and as competitive as we are, which is satanic, although it can produce good results, of course, is we then form two churches, one of which says, well, it means this, and the other one says, no, it doesn't, it means that, and they fight each other. But that's not what's going on. God isn't imprecise in order that he can cause confusion amongst churches. He's ambiguous, but he's totally precise in his ambiguity. In other words, every single possible meaning has valency. So what should happen is both churches to say, you know what, maybe you're right. They should cooperate and say, maybe the Holy Spirit revealed to you that this scripture could mean this, and the Holy Spirit revealed to us that the scripture could mean that. And maybe it's the same Holy Spirit, and maybe God means both things, and maybe we now know twice as much, rather than fighting each other over two possible meanings. And that's where we come in. Our job is to tell everybody that the book is ambiguous, and every possible particle of every letter and every possible ambiguous meaning of every particle of every letter and every sentence and every phrase will be fulfilled, does have power, and that is the genius of the creative literary work of the scriptures. That's what a scripture is, really, is something that has prophetic power disguised as ambiguity. Finally, my favourite, or one of my favourite, Isaiah 30, and, well, actually I prefer John 10, where it says, the Jews encircled Jesus during Hanukkah, the festival of the dedication, and said, you know, how long are you going to keep us in suspense? When are you lifting up our souls? Until when are you lifting up our souls, literally? Well, the Jews encircled him during Hanukkah. So it will be an encirclement of Hanukkah when the suspense ends and their souls are lifted up or stop being lifted up or whatever. And it's not a year encirclement, because that just puts you back in Hanukkah. It's a monthly encirclement. And the trouble that I've had with this, and also with Isaiah 30, which says the same thing, because it's got eight glowers and it's got a moon like a sun. Isaiah 30 says, the light of the moon will become like the light of the sun, and the light of the sun will become seven times as bright like the light of 7 days, in the day of the binding up of the breakdown of his people, which is also the day of the big slaughter. And that gives you the time period between the day of the small slaughter, which was 9/11. In the previous verse it says there will be rivers and streams and rivers on hills and mountains in the day of the big slaughter when the towers fall. Now, the small slaughter when the towers fell was 9/11. And 15 years, and either 1 or 2 months, which I never could get right, after that is when the big slaughter occurs. It's not quite that simple. It's 15 Hanukkahs and either 1 or 2 months. Because these suns and moons are called, well, the sun is called a glower. So it's literally the light of the moon becomes like the light of the glower, or glowing, and the light of the glower becomes seven times as bright like the light of 7 days. And what that gives you, we now know, is the light of the moon is like the light of a glower, so that's two moons. And then the glower becomes like seven glowers, so that gives you eight, which is a Hanukkah. And then like the light of 7 days, which is seven more. 8 plus 7 is 15. So you've got 15 Hanukkahs and two moons. Likewise with this encircling of the Jews. Obviously, one Jew cannot encircle Jesus. He needs a whole bunch of them. And if he was encircled by 20 rows of Jews, nobody would really say, or a crowd that was 20 deep, you know, thick, encircling him. Nobody would really say he was encircled 20 times. They'd say he was encircled once. However, this is coded. And a Greek plural counts as two. So the Jews encircled him, when you count that as a sentence count in the code, it just means two times. They encircled him two times. Encirclement isn't a year, it's a month. So it's 2 months after Hanukkah. Okay, at the festival of dedication, at Hanukkah, they encircled him twice, effectively. That takes you to a doubly late Hanukkah, or Shabbat 25 to Adar 2, rather than Shislev 25 to Tebeth 2. So that is when fast signs occur. That is when souls are lifted up. That is when the suspense is ended. That's how long you're going to keep us in suspense. Answer, until a many-versary of Hanukkah. In fact, a doubly late Hanukkah. Right, so I better give you the dates now. So we're now predicting, I mean, we've had to extend the prediction to run from, the 552nd prediction was for Hanukkah. Okay, then, and we've extended it, and now we're starting on, since we had to extend it, because these are extensions to an existing prediction, our new extended 552nd sub-prediction runs from 2016 Tishrei 25, which is the first day of Hanukkah, to 2016 Adar 2, which is the last day of doubly late Hanukkah. But we actually expect it during doubly late Hanukkah between Shabbat 25 and Adar 2, and in fact, furthermore, we expect it to be on or across the 24th Baalian Pentecost, which is the 78th Pentecost after the Sign of Jonah letter, which is Shabbat 30, Adar 1. And that is February 2, 3 or 4. That's when we expect it. The whole of the late Hanukkah will be to February 5, from the 28th of January. And we actually expect it on Shabbat 30, Adar 1, which is February the 2nd, 3rd or 4th. And with the 4 hours into the day, if that's right, this would be February the 2nd, about 4.5 or 5 hours after sunset, because the nights are a bit longer than a exact half of a day. So the hours are a bit longer in true terms than Gregorian hours we use. So that's when we expect these two terrorist attacks to occur, one producing a mushroom cloud above the Thames round about Dartford, and the other producing a mushroom cloud above the Hudson at Manhattan. Thanks very much.